Well, in this video, we are going to continue the control section for the industrial robotics course. So in this, for this topic, we are going to focus on the control system theory. So we have two types of control system. The first one is the open loop control system that is is characteristic is very important in this case because we don't have a feedback signal. So in this case, suppose that this is our block diagram, typical block diagram for the open loop control system that we receive as a reference input to the controller. The controller generates a manipulator variable that is going to affect the system of plan in order to generate a response. But in this case, there is no relationship between the output with the reference input. So, although this case, this kind of control system looks not too feasible or reliable, so it's very used in electrodomestic devices. For example, we had a toaster, we had a microwave, we had washing machines. So we have several devices that use this kind of control system that they don't need to use a feedback because it's cheap, it's easy to manufacture it, and because at the end, for example, in a toaster, you only to select the time level in order to have a toast bread. But in this case, it's not too important to have a very precise results. And then you can evaluate using your visual systems for the user to evaluate these results. So that's why it's very common to use this kind of system in very electrodomestic devices. And in contrast, we have the closed loop control system that in this case we need a feedback signal from the output in order to generate an error by comparing the input, the reference input, with this actual value for the output. And then this controller is going to use this error for to accomplish this reference input. This is very common in robotic systems because in this case it is necessary that we have a precise results for the robotic system. So suppose in this case we have these robotic systems, and then the idea is to move the end effector to a specific positions as a reference input, and then in this case you have these actuators, electrical motor, that use these sensors we call encoders in order to measure the angular position of this shaft, of this motor, that is used to compare with the desired position inside of this controller that is very common to use a electronic board, and then this is going to generate a voltage signal to the motor in order to move accordingly, in order to reduce this error between the desired position with the measured angle in order to accomplish this end effector position. Also, we have another classification. We have a single input, single output control system that is called like a CISO system, a multiple variable control system, a MIMO system, multiple inputs, multiple outputs, that also we need to include in our block diagrams. Now, focus on the controller block of these control systems. We have another additional blocks that also are very important. The importance of this is called the control algorithms. that includes the formula or the control law that is going to generate this signal to a driver that is going to affect the actuator of the systems. So in this case, for example, we have as a control law the proportional integral and derivative control systems that is going to use the error input to generate a signal that is going to affect the driver, and the driver is going to generate the final signal to the actuator of the systems. Now, in general, when we're talking about a control system, it's common to have these components. So we have a reference input, we have a measure value, we have a measure error that comes from this difference between the reference and the measure value. That this error is going to affect the controller. The controller, using this error, is going to generate a signal that we're going to call the manipulator variable, that is going to affect the system of the process as an input, in order to generate an output that is called the control variable. And also we need to include the perturbation variables, noises, distortions, that all these controllers need to compensate. Now, when we design any control system, the first step is to model these physical systems in order to obtain a mathematical description using this physical law or any of these mathematical representation that finish with the ordinary or differential equations. With this mathematical representation, the next step is to analyze this mathematical description in order to evaluate what is the behavior in order to compare with the physical system. And the most common to do that is to transform. If we have a nonlinear differential equations to a linear differential equations to have a cause-effect relations. And finally, the final step is to use a controller, select a controller, select a sensor, select an actuator, select what is the signal that is used as a feedback. So there is all these additional components that is going to function as a control system. Now, for the linear modeling, we have four methods to represent this linear equation. So we have the first one is using these ordinary differential equations. Other representation, we have the Laplace transform using the transfer function that relates the outputs divided by the input. With this transfer function, it's possible to use a block diagram that is a graphical form to represent the same idea. And finally, we have the space-state equations that is a matrix way to represent this relationship between these inputs, outputs, and some term that we are going to call the space variables, space state variables. So when we're talking about this linear element, we suppose that they can apply the superposition principle. In this superposition principle, we assume that, for example, we have two linear blocks with the inputs and outputs, and when we relate these two inputs with this linear equation, we have as a response a linear output from these two linear blocks. So that is the, in general idea, the superposition principle. Now, in order to obtain this linear differential equation from a nonlinear differential equation, we use some approximations. And one of these typical mathematical approximations is using the Taylor series that apply around a specific point that belongs to this nonlinear function. And the idea is to use infinite terms that come from the derivatives, evaluate around this point. So, in a complete Taylor series, you need to include as much as possible all these terms to have a very good approximation of this function. However, in our approach, the idea is to select only the linear terms to this nonlinear function. So, in many cases, using this idea, the first or maybe also the second terms of this Taylor series are used in order to have an approximation from a nonlinear system to a linear function. Now, if we suppose the point that we are going to select is zero, we have several functions that are very common to use, this nonlinear function and the linear approximation. For example, we have the sine, cosines, exponential function that are nonlinear functions with the some terms for the Taylor series, and then using only the linear components, we can have a linear approximation of these nonlinear functions. With this linear approximation, it's possible now to use the transfer function in terms of the Laplace transform using this relationship between the outputs divided by the inputs of the systems. And now it's possible also to obtain a block diagram representation. So we have an input that we are going to call the letter U and output with the letter Y. And in the block inside is this transfer function. So when you multiply the input times the transfer function, you obtain the output of the function. Now, the transfer function is very important because they have a very physical meanings, very important physical meanings respect with the numerator and the denominator of this transfer function. So in this case, it's difficult to obtain polynomials forms that is we focus on solve these polynomials in order to obtain the roots. These roots in the numerator is called the zeros, and the roots for the denominator are called the poles. Poles are very important because are related with the stability concept using this Laplace plane. In the Laplace plane, we have a real component and an imaginary component that is observed that if you have these values of these roots of these poles from the denominator polynomial of the transfer function are negatives, the real parts are negatives, or they are in the left side of this plane, the system is called stable. Another way to solve this root is using this function in MATLAB. The only thing that you need to use is the numerator and denominator of this transfer function, and then you obtain the poles of these transfer functions. So the Laplace transform is very common to use in order to obtain this transfer function. It's defined by this integral in order to change a function that is in terms of the time variable, in terms of the complex Laplace variable S. This complex variable S has one part that is in the real numbers and the complex part that is the frequency of the system in this plane for the x variable. Then the idea is to use the Laplace transform to change the variable, the time variable, to a s variable using some of these formulas that are very common to solve these problems, and then solve this polynomial Laplace transform variables, and then again to return to the time variables using the inverse Laplace transform. Also, in some cases, are necessary to use the Laplace transform theorems, that in this case we are more focused on the derivatives of these functions with respect to time in order to obtain these polynomials in terms of the Laplace transform variable. Now, let's solve this example. So suppose that we have this physical object. In this case, it's a simple pendulum that is 1 degree of freedom, theta. And in this case, we have a mass that is affected by the gravitational acceleration. And we have as an input the torque to position the to locate the mass to a specific position, velocity, acceleration. So the idea is to have a linear representation for this physical system. So for the solution, let's start with the dynamic model. This dynamic model is very known, and this is our typical nonlinear differential, ordinary differential equation for this mechanical systems, where we have a second order ordinary differential equation, non-homogeneous, and also we can see here we have these nonlinear terms. So that's why we need to change, to transform, or to have an approximation for this nonlinear ordinary differential equation to a linear ordinary differential equation using the Taylor series. So in this case, focus on the nonlinear term, that is the sine of theta. We can find an approximation around the point zero. So the idea is to have this around this zero, when theta is 0 radians in this position. So selecting this point, we have this approximation for this function, sine of theta, approximate to theta, to the same angle, theta, around this zero value, so for small values of theta, resulting at the end that this nonlinear ordinary differential equation can be approximate to this linear ordinary differential equations, only if and only if these theta are very small, so very close to 0 radians. So now is with this linear ordinary differential equation in function of time variables, is possible to obtain the transfer function using the Laplace transform with zero initial conditions for these equations, resulting with this polynomial of second degrees that at the end is possible to group in terms of the theta and the t that's going to represent the outputs and the inputs of the system. So the transfer function at the end is going to relate the outputs divided by the inputs, resulting this transfer function. With this transfer function, we can use a block diagram representation in this form, where we have as an input the torque and the output the position theta of the mass. So this is our final block diagram representation of this linear approximation for this physical system. Another example, including a diagram block diagram with a controller, is also very common. So suppose that this is this block diagram using a feedback system. This is a part of this sensor representation, and this is our reference. This is our transfer function for the plant, the system, or the process. This is the controller, and this is our output. With this transfer function as equations, we need to, in many cases, to have an equivalent block diagram that only relate the reference with the outputs. So let's start doing this solution. So from the initial diagram, block diagram, we can reduce. The idea is to reduce to obtain this diagram that only going to represent the relationship between the reference and the output. So the idea is to obtain what is the new equivalent transfer function for this closed loop block diagram. Now we can start using a reduction or free reduction, you find this multiplication between these two diagrams that result in this first block reduction of this diagram, and then with this now we add this variable that we are going to call E, that is the error, so this is the difference between the reference and the feedback signal. And then let's write down two equations. Let's start with the first equation that is going to relate this reference minus the sensor multiplied by the input in order equals to the error in order to obtain the first equation for this block diagram. The second equation is going to come from this part, so it's the error times this block diagram equals the output, the Y output. So we have two equations. Let's substitute the first equation into the second equations, and then doing this algebraic operations, we can obtain our transfer function that is going to relate the output divided by the input by this formula. Then this fraction is going to represent the transfer function of these systems that at the end is going to have an equivalent block diagram between the only reference, that is the input, and the output of the system with the variable Y. So substituting these transfer functions for the controller, the plant, and the sensor in our general transfer function, we obtain our final transfer function for this initial block diagram. So this is our way to analyze and first step this control system, assuming that we need to doing this linear transformations.